We're gonna talk now about vectorized operations, a couple of methods and sorting for Pandas series. The reason that we've pretty much squeezed all these topics in this lecture is that most of what we're gonna see now is the same or works in the same way as we saw with NumPy, especially vectorized operations and the methods that we can use. So if you went through the NumPy videos and exercises, you will get this pretty quickly. If you didn't and you want more detail, please go to NumPy, because what we're gonna see now is just at a glance. We are gonna borrow the same concepts we saw on the NumPy section. So to get things started, we have a regular G7 pop series, and we are creating a new one that is the GDP of each one of these countries. So the indices are aligned: Canada, France, Germany, Canada, France, and Germany. These are kind of equivalent series in terms of their index. We have, where of course, storing different data. Population in G7 pop, and with the GDP series, we're storing, of course, the GDP of each one of these countries. The first couple of operations we're gonna see with pandas and series, and the same thing is going to happen with DataFrames. They will be in the form of methods, you're going to see. So in this case, we have, for example, the head or the tail. These methods are just for you to see how they work. They're going to be usually just dot the method, parentheses, and the parameter. So each one of these is an object. You know already about object-oriented programming. We're going to be using these methods. So the first thing we want to tackle very quickly is the concept of vectorized operations with Pandas series. That, again, it's going to be pretty much the same thing as you know already from NumPy. So using this series, if we can just add any sort of mathematical operation, we can perform any sort of mathematical operation in the series, and it will be applied on an element-wise way. So in this case, what we can see is that when we multiply by a million, what we're actually doing, the expression is this series multiplied by a million. It's the same thing again as a NumPy array. And the result is that each individual item is being multiplied by a million. Remember that all these operations are immutable. The series is not changing. The underlying series is not changing. If I show you again the contents of G7 pop, you will see that it's the same as it was before. We're not changing it. We're returning, sorry, the operation is returning a new series. So again, any mathematical operation you want to add, it's going to just work with the series. Something else that we will be able to do is, in this case, we can pretty much create operations between series. So as these two series, they share the index, we can, and they are kind of aligned. If you put them together, they have the same indices. What we can do is we can actually divide or multiply, or some, we can perform mathematical operations with these series. So in this case, we're calculating GDP per capita, right? This is the operation, GDP per capita. And the way we are doing it is by just multiplying the GDP series by the population series. These operations, they all work. You always have to make sure that you're using the correct set of parentheses whenever there is an important precedence that you want to talk about, or just because you have different precedents in your operations. But again, all these operations, they are chainable if you want. You can keep adding these operations involving multiple series. These will always work out as it's obvious. So remember also from NumPy, we said that most of these operations, they're very fast. First of all, they're very fast, optimized in memory. And the reason was because they were universal functions. Internally, they are coded with a very efficient compile, usually C Fortran code that runs, you know, machine level code. These universal functions were not just limited to the regular mathematical operators we knew. We had a battery of multiple operations, like, for example, maximum, minimum, the mean, the standard deviation, etc., that we could run. And the same thing for more of like aggregation methods. So, for example, something like G7 pop.sum, right? All these operations, they are all very fast in memory. The same thing that is happening right here. There is one extra method with series, with series, which is very important, and I've left without executing, which is the describe method. And by the way, it's not only series, it will also be useful with data frames. And the describe method, what it does, it gives you a summary of your series with the most important methods, statistical methods, we could say. So in this case, it counts how many non-null elements you have, what's the mean, the standard deviation, the minimum, the maximum, and in this case, 3 percentiles, 25th percentile, 15th percentile, and 75th percentile. And we can actually run a couple others. In this case, we have, for example, quantiles. There are multiple methods, something you will usually pick up as you need it. It's very hard, to be honest, to memorize these methods. It's just you will be using them so often. You will the usual process we follow is we need a method, we Google for it, you find the method you were looking for, you start using it, and after using it a couple of times, it becomes very familiar. Finally, something neat from Pandas is that it works very well with NumPy. It has a very, very good interwork between Pandas and NumPy. So pretty much any function, universal function from NumPy also applies to Pandas series. So in this case, we are applying the logarithmic function to our Pandas series. The parameter that we are passing to our log method is indeed a Pandas series. Finally, a little bit of sorting. This is very simple with data frames. What we have right here, or usually the two important things when we need to sort a series, is first understanding what you want to sort, if you want to sort the index or the value. So in this case, we are sorting, of course, values. The method is sort values. And also the direction that you're going to use to sort. So in this case, by default, the sorting is going to be ascending, 35, 60, 63, etc. Ascending order. If you want descending order, what you have to do is set ascending in false. So this is not very intuitive, but instead of saying descending true, we actually have to say ascending false. And this is going to be, of course, the opposite direction from the largest one to the smallest one. Remember that all these methods are immutable. They are not changing the underlying series. I can sort everything, but the original series remains the same. France, Canada, France, Germany, etc. This is returning a new series. Usually, what you're going to do is you're going to get a hold of it on another variable, population sorted, for example, and then start using that series. If you want to modify the original series, the underlying series, you want to sort it and modify it, you want it to be a mutable operation, you have to pass the in-place parameter. Okay, so again, our series is not modified. I now run the sorting in ascending mode, as actually descending mode, and I say in-place equals true. So that means in-place means sort the series and write it back again to the actual series, modify the original series. You're gonna see that this method returns nothing. I run it, it returns nothing. Okay, so this is a very good hint. When a method is immutable, it actually returns the result. Of course, you need the result. When the method is mutable, it returns none, because it's basically saying, I have already applied that operation to the underlying series. If you want to check that out, you have to go to the underlying series that I have just modified. So when I do it, we see that now the series is modified. It wasn't. I run the method and now the series is modified with the value. With the correct order. And again, as I told you, what do you want to sort? We said first the values. We can also sort the index, right? So in this case, we're sorting the index. You can check the documentation of these methods right there. So pretty much everything that we saw for sort values also applies to sort index, ascending, in place, etc. We can actually define the type of plot. Don't give a lot of emphasis or importance to these parameters. We're going to see more about them when we start with hierarchical indices. But again, at least ascending and in place are part of sort index if you want it. Sorting the index will not change the data in any way. It's just rearranging the index in any particular ways because you need it. So again, sorting is first deciding what you want to sort, the values or the index, in what direction, and if you want to modify the original series or not. This is going to be very similar in Pandas DataFrames. So just keep an eye for it for later. It's going to be useful once we start working with DataFrames.